Welcome to the webinar called Designing Cosmetic Products in the Compliance with Europe and US Market. This webinar was done with the aim of showing to the manufacturer and brands how easy could be make your product comply with US regulation once your product comply with European regulation. We will see the relevant point. Here, explain you the similarity and discrepancy between them, and what you have to take account when you manufacture a product to sell in the two markets. This webinar is done by Cosme Service. We are a company specialized in the registration of the cosmetic product in Europe. The time of the webinar will be about 45 minutes. If you have any question, you can send us by email, and we will answer you as soon as possible. Also, we will send you the presentation. The webinar will be done by Estefania Benjoc and me, Ana Hernández. First, we will see the framework of the both regulations, then the mandatory information for each one. After, we present the ingredient and which one is allowed or forbidden in each market. Following up the ingredient, the labeling and what is needed in it. In the point 5, we will see the claim and its regulation. After that, the different notification in each market. Almost finishing, the regulation that can have the different states in the United States, in America, or in the countries in Europe. And finally, a little summary of all the presentation. I hope you like it. Let's begin. The first point that we are going to talk about is the legislation that is applicable to the cosmetic product in the United States and in Europe. In the United States, is the Federal Food, Drug and Cosmetic Act who protect the consumer from unsafety and deceptionally labeled and packaging product by providing the movement in interstate commerce of adulterated and misbranding food, drug, devices and cosmetics. Also, is the Fair Packaging and Labeling Act, which ensures the packaging and their label provide consumers with accurate information about the quantity of content and facility value compilation. In Europe, is the European Regulation 1223/2009 about cosmetic products, which ensures the product under normal or reasonable condition of use, doesn't present any risk on the human health. The product must be commercialized respecting the usual and legal labeling condition for the different kind of product. Besides the regulation, also there are some organizations that can support you in the cosmetic product development. For example, with the ingredient, the mode of use, the surface of application, in the manufacturing of product. In US market is the Cosmetic Ingredient Review, and in Europe is the European Commission. Moreover, there are guidelines like the SCCS note of guidance of the testing cosmetic ingredient in the and their safety evaluation in Europe, or the guide to United States cosmetic product compliance requirements for US. Later, we are going to speak a bit more about some of them. The definition of cosmetic is almost the same in the both places, Europe and US. The difference between them is that European regulation is more specific. While in US only say human body, in European legislation point the part that is allowed the use of the cosmetic, like skin or nails. The same case happens with the intent of use of the cosmetic. In US, use a general term like beautifying, while in Europe, it specifies the term like perfuming or keeping in a good condition. In the slides, there is shown the definition of the cosmetic according to European regulation. U2 is the most complete. I would like to call your attention about some products that in Europe are cosmetic, but in America can be cosmetic or drug. In US, a cosmetic is also a drug when it's intended to cleanse, beautify, and promote attractiveness, as well as treat or prevent disease, or otherwise affect the structure or any function of the human body. This definition is based on the use intended for the consumer. Moreover, there are several monographs in FDA about borderline products that can be classified in different groups of products. Let's see some examples. A product will be drug or cosmetic depend of the ingredient, the claim, and the intended use. In Europe, the antiperspirant product is a cosmetic, but in US, it's a drug. Same as the anti-dandruff shampoo or the moisturizing cream with SPA that contains UV filter. Also happen with the toothpaste with fluorides. But that a product could be a different kind of product is not only the US market. Nowadays, it's normal to have a hand cleanser in the pocket. In Europe, this product can be a cosmetic or a biocide, while in US, this product is a drug. One of the advantages of marketing your product in United States and Europe is that the regulation covers a big territory. FDA's responsibilities extend to the 50 states of the United States, the District of Columbia, Puerto Rico, Guam, the Virgin Islands, American Samoa, and other United States territory and possessions. If you comply with the European regulation, you can sell the product in the 27 countries of the European Union, plus Norway, Liechtenstein, Iceland and Sweden. The European market is the first in sales with 78,600 million of euro, following for the American market with 75,800 million of euros. Your products will be commercialized in the two best wall powder. Now, in the point two, general requirement. Some of the principal differences between both regulations are the toxicological profile, the language, and the paperwork. In US, there is no toxicological control. The manufacturer is the responsible for the safety of the product. In Europe, it's needed that an expert review the product and give the approbation. Regarding the language, the English is enough for all the states of US. Except some of them that is allowed with Spanish. In Europe, according to the country in which the product is going to be sold, is needed to appear in the label the official language of the country. As I mentioned before, in Europe, is needed an expert to review the product and perform a dossier about the toxicological profile and study of the ingredient, between other more things. In USA, is not needed this kind of paperwork. The mandatory step to introduce your product in one of these countries in a big line are: in US, it's needed that the manufacturer comply with the good manufacturing process, and the label can be misleading. These are the points more important in America. Then, when your product is already marketed, you can notify in the voluntary cosmetic registration program. In Europe, is needed a product information file, the notification of the cosmetic product in the European portal, and a responsible person who will place it in Europe. Also, we have to take in account some products that in America market have to comply with extra regulation. This is the case of the cosmetic for children. For example, the lead content is limited to 100 parts per million. Additionally, certain children toys and child care articles cannot contain more than 0.1% of 6 different phthalates. Moreover, packaging and container holding children cosmetics are subject to Cosmetic Product Safety Improvement Act compliance. These extras are applicable to product designing for child's age 12 years or younger. In addition, there are states in US and countries in Europe with its own regulation. Some of them we will see in another point of the presentation. In this slide, there are a little summary of the document and the point that the expert of Europe have to gather and study to ensure the safety of the cosmetic product. The dossier has two parts, A and B. The most important part is the B, where the expert in cosmetic products of the European market make the assessment conclusion and determine if the cosmetic product is safe and safe or need more information to determine it. Now continue my colleague Estefania.
Welcome to everybody. It's Estefania speaking. I'm going to talk about the ingredient labeling and legislation in different states. So let's start. Firstly, I'm going to talk about the ingredients in the United States and Europe. In the United States, the safety of most cosmetic ingredients is determined not by FDA or other government agency, but yes, by the Cosmetic Ingredient Review. The FDA regulates cosmetic labeling under the authority of Food, Drug and Cosmetic Act and the Fair Packaging and Labeling Act. These laws and the related regulation are intended to protect consumers from health hazards. Furthermore, help consumers make informed decisions about the personal care products they buy. At the bottom of the slide, it can be seen the Cosmetic Ingredient Review logo. This entity was founded in 1976 by Cosmetic, Toiletry and Fragrance Association. The Cosmetic Ingredient Review charge is to identify those cosmetic ingredients for which there is reasonably safety under its conditions of use. On the left, we can see the Cosmetic Ingredient Review Expert Panel. It is composed by a toxicologist, consumer representative of America, dermatologist, cosmetic industry scientist, executive and president. Their responsibility is to study individual chemical compounds as they are used in cosmetic products. For each cosmetic ingredient, the expert panel considers usage data, chemical properties, structure and nomenclature, biological responses, and toxicology, clinical and epidemiologic data. For a complete assessment, data on local effects, for example, skin and eye irritation, dermal sensitization, and systemic effects must be evaluated. Now, what we have on the slide is regulation for safety cosmetic products in Europe. As my colleague Anna has said before, the main goal of the European regulation is to ensure a high level of protection of public health and harmonize community standards in order to achieve a safe internal market for cosmetic products. So, this legislation controls all the ingredients of cosmetic products. If we check, we can see forbidden products, substances listed in Annex 2. Restricted substances appear in the Annex 3. Colorants allowed in Annex 4. Preservatives allowed in Annex 5. And UV filters allowed in the Annex 6. Okay, so let's go. In Europe, forbidden substances are listed in the Annex 2. In this annex, there are more than 1,600 forbidden substances, including CMR, carcinogenic, mutagenic, and reprotoxic. For example, the latest substances that have been included in this annex are lyral. It shouldn't be used in cosmetic products. It's a fragrance allergen which caused the highest number of contact allergies cases in last years. Other latest example is cyclotetraxyloxane, D4. The European Commission has classified it as persistent, bioaccumulative, and toxic. Let's move on forbidden ingredients in US. On the other hand, in the United States, there are only a negative list in which appear 9 ingredients. It can be seen on the right side. Some examples of these ingredients are bitinol, which is forbidden because it may cause photocontact sensitization. Mercury compounds, which are readily absorbed through the skin on topical application and tend to accumulate in the body. Another example is vinyl chloride, which is forbidden as an ingredient of aerosol products because it causes cancer and other health problems. We can move forward to next slide, colorants. In Europe, as I said before, colorants allowed in cosmetic products appear in the Annex 4 of the regulation. They are about 153 substances admitted. If we compare this with colorants in the United States, there are some differences. First of all, in the United States, all colorant additives require to be listed by FDA, and there are 2 categories. Color additives that are subject to FDA certification process, and others which are exempt from this certification. Color additives subject to BAS certification are usually synthetic organic dyes, lakes, or pigments. And the others, exempt from the certification, generally include colorants derived from plant or mineral sources. So, what is the color additive certification? This certification is the process by which FDA assures that newly manufactured batches of color additives meet the identity and specification requirements of the recent regulation. Okay, right. Let's move on to our first big area of the day. And our first big area talk about the labeling. In the United States, the Cosmetic Labeling Guide provides a step-by-step help with cosmetic labeling about requirements under US laws. However, in Europe, labeling requirements appear on the Article 19 of the European Regulation. In Europe, the European regulation about cosmetic products, the requisites are responsible person, is legal or natural person who places cosmetic products on the market. This person shall ensure compliance with obligations set out regulation. Country of origin. This point shall be specified for imported cosmetic products. Nominal content, given by weight or by volume, except in the case of packaging containing less than 5 grams on 5 milliliters. 3 samples. Expiry date is the date until which the cosmetic product stored under appropriate conditions will continue to fulfill its initial properties. It appears on the packaging and shall be preceded by a time clock or the period of time after opening. Function of the product, which led to the consumer identity the product. Warnings. Particular precautions to be observed in use, and at least those listed in Annex 3 to 6. Ingredient list. The list of ingredients shall be established in descending order at the time the ingredients are added to the cosmetic product. Ingredients in concentrations of less than 1% may be listed in any order after those in concentrations of more than 1%. This list shall be established preceded by the term ingredients. Related to nanomaterials, the names of such ingredients shall be followed by the word nano in brackets. Language shall be the official by the law of the member states in which the product is made available to the end user. These points are very important that appear on the outward products to launch in European market. Okay, so I think the next part, US labeling, is a little more complicated and a little more colorful than European labeling. I hope you are ready. Let's go and take a look. In US, label may consist of more than one panel. It may consist of a front panel, side panels, and a back panel. Back and side panels are generally called information panels. The principal display, PDP, is the main face of the product. That's the first thing viewed the consumer. The front panel is relative to primary packaging. It's the main face of the product. It is not visible for the consumer when this container is included in the packaging box. The information panel, it can be the side or back side of the product. We are going to focus on the labeling and outer container product. This applies to label of the outer container, which usually is a box folding carton holding the inner container. However, if the immediate container holding the cosmetic product is not displayed in a box, it also helps like an outer container and this information applied. FDA Cosmetic Labeling Guide establishes for outer container and single container product. Name of the product. Identity. 741 zero warning. Net quantity of contents. All of them must appear on the principal display panel, PDP, which usually is a box or folding carton. Okay, let's go to see what information shall appear on the sides and back. It shall appear. Direction of use. Warnings. Name and place of business. Ingredient declaration. It's important to know that if the net quantity of content, the area of PDP, is less than 5 square inches, the minimum height of the tag size will be 0.1587 centimeters. If the PDP area is between 5 and 25 square inches, the tag size will be 0.12 centimeters. And if the PDP area is between 25 and 100 square inches, the nominal content tag size will be 0.18 centimeters. In addition, the net content statement must appear within the bottom 30% of PDP panel container, generally parallel in line to the base on which package rests. Nevertheless, this slide brings me to the inner container labeling. For this type of products, FDA established the following point shall appear on the artwork. On the front panel shall appear the name of the product. And on the information panels, including size and box, must appear directions of use, warnings, name and place of business, and net quantity of contents. To illustrate this point, we are going to do two examples, one for US labeling and other for Europe. First of all, it's needed to remember that the first big difference between United States and Europe is that the artwork has two different areas, principal display panel and information panel. In Europe, have both different panels. You can write the information along the artwork. In this case, in the slide, we have a relaxing body oil product by Chanel brand. It doesn't have a box, so the front panel will be the same as principal display panel. It can be seen on the picture that this artwork has two information panels. So, we can start to check the points that must appear in this product. On the PDP panel, we can see the name of the product, The identity. Regarding the 740.0 warnings, don't apply to this product because these specific warnings apply to cosmetic aerosol, feminine deodorant sprays, and foaming detergent bath products. And the net weight content appear too. Relating to the information panels appear the directions of use. In this case, there is no mandatory warnings. The name and place of business, and the ingredient list. Now, we are going to look at the Europe labeling points. In the product you have on the screen, we may find responsible person, nominal content, country of origin, period after opening, ingredients, warnings, function, claims, and batch reference. Therefore, this adword comply with European regulation. So, comparing law requirements between Europe and US, we can find the similarities below. First, responsible person and name and place of business is the legal or natural person who places cosmetic products on the market. This person shall ensure compliance with the relevant obligation set up regulation. Relative to nominal content, in Europe and United States, is mandatory in primary and secondary packaging. Besides the function, is the same that identity, and it's mandatory in both. Regarding the warnings, in US, there are specific regulation called 741.0 warnings that in Europe doesn't exist. That's why these specific warnings, as I said before, are for cosmetic aerosol, feminine deodorant sprays, and foaming detergent bath products. On the last point is the ingredients list, where the ingredients shall be appear in the standard order of weight. Now, my colleague Anna will explain the claims.
Manufacturers have persuaded consumers with promises of everything from new beauty to a new lifestyle. Indeed, with cosmetics, perhaps more than with any other type of product, promotion is the key to sales success. Recognizing this, enterprises have used a wide variety of appeals to break into or increase their share in this lucrative market. But not all the claims are ROI. In US, the responsible of care the claims in the product is the Federal Trade Commission and the FDA. In Europe, is the regulation 655/2013 about cosmetic claims, which regulates the claim, and then the member states are the manager to make comply them. In Europe, the regulation ensures the claims have to comply with 6 points. Legal compliance. Your product can't say that comply with the regulation because all the products have to do it. So, this symbol or any similar one are forbidden. Truthfulness. You can lie about your product, what it is or what it has. If your product claims that contain lemon and mint, the product has to have this ingredient. Evidential support. Every claim should be provided by any support, test, report, biography. In this product is dermatologically tested, so the product must to have a test. Honesty. The claim has to be honest. This product doesn't contain sulfate and salt, but there are a lot of kinds of sulfate and salt. So we should review the list of the ingredients for checking the product and see if this claim is true. Fairness. Some ingredients are alloy, so it's not fair that brand claim against them. Due to product, use them legally. For example, 0% phenocyanol. The phenocyanol is a alloy preservative. Informed decision making. The claim has not to be misleading. This product have to be well labeled, the function, the mode of use, or for example, this that is only for professional use. In US, there are only two requirements for claims. The claim has to be truthfulness and the label has to be not misleading. That is very important because depending on the kind of claim of the product, it can be a cosmetic, drug, or both. For example, if a cosmetic is intending to make line and wrinkle less noticeable simply by moisturizing the cream, it's a cosmetic. But if the product tries to remove wrinkle or increase the skin production of collagen, it's a drug or a medical device because the product intended to affect the structure or function of the body, such as the skin. Here, there are some polemic claims in US. Aromatherapy. Such claims are sometimes made for product containing essential oils and make it as aromatherapy. The fact that a fragrance material or other ingredient came from a plant doesn't keep it from being regulated as a drug. So, if a product such as our health is intended only to clean the body, it's a cosmetic. If the product is intended for a therapeutic use, such as treating or preventing disease, it's a drug. Hypoallergenic. There are no federal standards or definitions that govern the use of the term hypoallergenic. The term means whatever a particular company wanted to mean. Manufacturer label and advertise this cosmetic as hypoallergenic. Sorry. Or make similar claims without any supporting evidence. Consumer will have no assurance that such claims are valid. Organic. This term is not regulated by FDA. It's due for US Department of Agriculture. Oversee the National Organic Program. The National Organic Program regulation include a definition of organic and provide for the certification that agricultural ingredients have been produced under conditions that will meet the definition. There are also included labeling standard basis on the percentage of organic ingredient in a product. Cosmetic product labeled with organic claim must comply with both USDA and FDA regulation. No animal testing or cruelty free. These claims are quite similar to hypoallergenic because there are no legal definition for this term. For example, there are raw material that used to be proved in animal before, but now they aren't. The claim can refer that nowadays they are not proving the raw material in animals. Now, we are going to talk about what happens if you don't comply with the regulation. In US, if you don't comply with the regulation issue of the cosmetic product, the FDA sends you a warning letter. This letter are issued to achieve voluntary compliance to the established advance notice. This letter are based on the expectation that the majority of people and companies want to voluntarily comply with the law. If you regret the letter or the issue is a safety problem with the consumer, FDA can request that a firm recall a product. In Europe, each member state has its own penalties and, according to regulation, they have to be effective, proportionate and dissuasive. The most of the time, these penalties are money fine, and only in the extremely case of safety of the consumer, they end in recall of the product. The sixth point is the notification in the system. Voluntary cosmetic registration program is a reporting system for use by manufacturer, packer, and distributor of cosmetic products that are in commercial distribution in the United States. It doesn't apply to cosmetic products for professional use only, such as products used in beauty salon, spa, or skincare clinic. It also doesn't apply to products that aren't for sale, such as hotel samples, free gift, or cosmetic products you make in your home. The Voluntary Cosmetic Registration Program is not a cosmetic approval program or a promotional tool. Cosmetics are not subject to FDA pre-market approval. The Cosmetic Product Notification Portal is the online notification system created for the application of European regulations. Only a single notification is made at European level. However, we would like to highlight that the notification is not the same as registration. It must be clear, because the fact that a cosmetic product has been properly notified in the CPMP doesn't necessarily imply that it complies with all the requirements of regulation. The CPMP notification is mandatory. Both notifications can be done online. Regarding the CPMP, here a little summary about what it is, a notification. Who has to do it? Responsible person of distributor. Why is needed to do it? To make the information of the cosmetic product available to the poison center. When it has to be done? Before placing the product in the market. And how is possible to do it? Well, I have the web page where you can do it. In this slide, there is information that you need to know to make your notification. First of all, you need to create an account. After that, you have to register your company in the SAAS as responsible person or distributor. This step needs a validation. In one account, you can have several companies, and you will receive an ID for each one of them. Once you have the validation of your company, you can access to the CPMP. There, you can add the information of your cosmetic product, like name, country of origin, formulation, label, and you will receive a CPMP reference for each product. The CPMP number is not needed to appear in the label. Here, the same summary for the Voluntary Cosmetic Registration Program. What it is? A system to reporting. Who has to do it? Individual establishment, cosmetic firm, foreign firm. Why is needed to do it? Because provide information to the FDA about the cosmetic market and ingredient. When has to be done? After marketing, if your product exceeds of $1,000. How can you do it? Well, I have the page of the registration. For the Voluntary Cosmetic Registration Program, first you have to create an account. Then you have two options. The first one is the Form 2511, and this only owner or operator of cosmetic manufacturing or packaging facilities can register the establishment using a separate form 2511 for each facility location. Then they can receive a registration number. The second option is the Filling Cosmetic Product Ingredient Statement, CPIS, format 2512. A cosmetic manufacturer, packer, or distributor can fill a statement for each product that the firm has entered into the commercial distribution. Use a separate form 2512 for its formulation. Here, you will have to complete the information of your product, like ingredient list or category code. And then you receive for each formulation a CPIS number. Here, we make a small summary of the both notifications. In Europe, the notification is mandatory, while in US, it's optional. In US, the notification is done after the product is in the market, and in Europe, it's done before. The next point is a reminder about that the notification doesn't mean that the product complies with the regulation staff in any of the both cases. Regarding the format, in US, you can't make notification, make only one or another format or both of them, while in Europe, it's mandatory to notify the product. You can do it under the responsible person or distributor profile, but it has to be done. Now, continue my colleague Estefania.
So, moving on to the next point, different states. California has its own regulation called Proposition 65. It is also known as the Safe Drinking Water and Toxic Control Act. It was approved in 1986 in California, and its goal was to preserve and protect sources of drinking water from harmful substances to health. Therefore, it's necessary for any company interested in operating in California to sell products in this state comply with Proposition 65. This list is updated and nowadays includes approximately 900 toxic substances. It includes a wide variety of synthetic and natural chemicals, from additives, pesticides, ingredients. On the other hand, it's also important to take account other regulations. We go beyond the regulations that are applicable in each country of the European Union for importing of cosmetic products in this region. Portugal, imported products require registration in cosmetics. Slovenia, when it's the first country of import, importers and responsible person must complete a notification from of the activity in the products of these chemicals. Estonia, teeth whitening products that contain hydrogen peroxide or release hydrogen peroxide in proportion less 0. So, we have covered about legislation on Europe and United States. In this chart, we can find some takeaway ideas to remember. In United States, the notification is voluntary, but in Europe, to notify the cosmetic product in CPNP is mandatory. Regarding ingredients, in the United States, there are only 9 ingredients forbidden. However, the European regulation is more restrictive compared with US. That's why in Europe, there are 1 forbidden ingredient list, 1 restrictive list, 3 allowed listings, colorants, preservatives, and UV filters. On the other hand, related to scientific committee, which support and provides analysis to the safety of consumer, in Europe is CCS, and in US, Cosmetic Ingredient Review. Relative to the inky name of the ingredients which appear on the ingredient list, in US, the inky name are a bit different than in Europe. For example, in United States, it's called water, and in Europe, aqua. Another example is fragrance and perfume for Europe. On the other hand, the responsible person in US accepted foreign addresses, but in Europe, is mandatory that this person has a European address. Next point is expiry date. For US, it's not necessary that appear, but in Europe, it's mandatory the sun clock or the period after opening symbol. Okay, that's all, guys. That's the end of our webinar of today. I hope you found it interesting and informative. I would also like to thank you for your assistance in this webinar. You can send us your questions by email and we will be grateful to reply them directly. It has been a pleasure to keep in contact with all of you. And remember, Cosme Service will make your ideas happen, working together and being your reliable partner in matters of European cosmetic regulation. We hope to see you again in the following webinar. Bye!